Hello everyone, in this session we are going to discuss another branch of the external carotid artery, that is the occipital artery. Now the occipital artery arises from the external carotid high up in the neck, below the mandible, and it actually arises within the digastric triangle. So to get to the beginnings of the occipital artery, you have to go up high up above the hyoid and close to the mandible, and then the posterior belly of the digastric, and then if you can actually cut down and bring it below, if you can remove the posterior belly of the digastric, then it will be easier for you to see the occipital artery. So the occipital artery, the beginning of it you can see in the digastric triangle, then the occipital artery from the anterior triangle, that is from the digastric triangle, it will go on to the apex of the posterior triangle. From the apex of the posterior triangle, it will go up into the margins of the suboccipital triangle, which is another dissection area, and from the suboccipital triangle it will move up into the scalp, which is another area of study. So the occipital artery traverses digastric triangle, posterior triangle, suboccipital region and scalp, four zones. So let us take them one by one. First we will look at the beginnings of the occipital artery. That means we say that this is the external carotid artery, this is the internal carotid artery, and here you have the common carotid artery. And the external carotid artery is dividing, say, somewhere here into maxillary and superficial temporal arteries, and somewhere here you had the superior thyroid artery, somewhere here you had the lingual artery, somewhere here you had the facial artery, and somewhere here you have the occipital artery going back. So this is the occipital artery going back across the internal carotid artery and going back up towards the suboccipital region and the scalp. So this is the occipital artery, and this occipital artery you can see in the digastric triangle. Now we have already said the regions that are to be traversed by the occipital artery, and now we come to the branches of the occipital artery. Now suppose you look at the occipital artery, it gives upper and lower sternomastoid branches. So upper sternomastoid branch, lower sternomastoid branch. Now upper stern, both of these are going to supply the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which is like this, a patch over the carotid sheath. Now upper sternomastoid muscle is accompanied by the spinal accessory nerve, and the lower sternomastoid artery is hooked by the hypoglossal nerve. So upper sternomastoid, lower sternomastoid, accompanied by spinal accessory, hooked by hypoglossal. Apart from the upper and lower sternomastoid branches of the occipital artery, you already know that this superior thyroid artery also gives the sternocleidomastoid branch. So you have sternomastoid branches, two prominent branches from the occipital artery and another prominent branch from the superior thyroid artery. Now let us look at these sternomastoid branches. We are saying that this is the occipital artery, and we are saying this is the upper sternomastoid branch, and this is the lower sternomastoid branch. And then we have to draw the sternocleidomastoid muscle itself, say like this. Say this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle. And you have an upper sternomastoid and a lower sternomastoid branch. Now the upper sternomastoid branch is accompanied by the accessory nerve, which goes into the sternocleidomastoid, and the lower sternomastoid is actually hooked by the hypoglossal nerve. So you have the hypoglossal nerve and you have the accessory nerve. Accessory nerve with the upper sternomastoid branch and hypoglossal nerve with the lower sternomastoid branch. So this is the way it is. So one set of branches we have already covered, the upper and lower sternomastoid branch. Apart from this, it gives several muscular branches. When it is passing all these areas, the digastric triangle, then the apex of the posterior triangle, then the suboccipital region, mainly when it is going into the suboccipital region from the posterior triangle. Now if we look at this course, then again if we draw the, you see this occipital artery, you have to draw the digastric muscle, and if we draw the posterior belly of the digastric is somewhat like this. See, here you have the posterior belly of the digastric and here you have the anterior belly. So the posterior belly of the digastric, the occipital artery is following the lower edge and the deeper plane of the posterior belly of the digastric. Now this digastric is going to get, see, this is the mastoid process, and this sternomastoid is attached to the tip of the mastoid process and passing over from the mastoid process to the occipital bone, and this digastric muscle is attached to the groove on the medial surface of the mastoid process, and this occipital artery is going to go into the groove still medial to the posterior belly of the digastric. How then are you going to represent that in pictures? You are going to represent that in pictures very easily by drawing the lower surface of the base of the skull. If you draw the under surface of the base of the skull, then suppose here you are drawing the foramen magnum, and somewhere here you are drawing the rest of the skull, and this is the petrous part of the temporal bone, and somewhere here you have the mastoid part of the temporal bone. So this is the mastoid process, and if you have the mastoid process here, then you have sternomastoid, splenius capitis and longissimus capitis, the three muscles, and deep to the attachment of the sternomastoid, so if you draw the mastoid process like this, you have the groove for the posterior belly of the digastric. So here you have the groove for the posterior belly of the digastric, and still deeper to that, this is the groove for the we have to draw from superficial to deep. So if this is the mastoid process, here is the groove for the posterior belly of the digastric, and this is the groove for the occipital artery. So more superficially, deep to the tip of the mastoid, you have the groove for the posterior belly of the digastric, and still medially you have a groove for the occipital artery, and you can see now that the occipital artery is going into the suboccipital region, and it is going to go up into the scalp. So if you draw the digastric, again if you draw the triangles of the neck, suppose you draw the triangles of the neck, this is the mandible, and this is the tympanic plate, and this is the mastoid process, and you have the sternocleidomastoid over here like this, and you have the anterior triangle, and you have the posterior triangle with the trapezius, and you have the digastric triangle over here like this. So you are going to have the occipital artery going like this in this direction, and then you have the occipital artery over here crossing the apex of the posterior triangle, and then you have the occipital artery going up. So you have the occipital artery here in the digastric triangle, this is first part, then you have the occipital artery in the apex of the posterior triangle, that is the second part, then you have the occipital artery in the suboccipital region, that is the third part, and you have the occipital artery in the scalp, that is the fourth part. And when it is going from the tip of the posterior triangle up into the suboccipital region, it is passing on a groove deep to the posterior belly of the digastric and deep to the tip of the mastoid process. So you have the tip of the mastoid process over here, the apex, and medial to the tip you have the groove for the digastric, and still medial to that you have the occipital artery. Now when you are looking at the suboccipital region, if you draw the suboccipital region like this, suppose you are drawing the you are drawing the occipital bone like this. So this is the occipital bone, and this is the external occipital protuberance, external occipital crest, the superior nuchal line, inferior nuchal line, superior nuchal line, inferior nuchal lines, and highest nuchal line. And you know the occipital artery is going to come up like this. This is how the occipital artery is coming up. And when it is here, it is in the suboccipital region, and when it is going up above the superior nuchal line, it is in the scalp. So there's again, there is a part of the occipital artery in the digastric triangle, part of the occipital artery in the apex of the posterior triangle, part of the occipital artery in the suboccipital region over here, and a part of the occipital artery here in the scalp. So it has gone up in the scalp as well. So you have so many parts of the suboccipital artery. Now when it is in the suboccipital region, here you have the semispinalis capitis and the superior oblique muscle. Now when this occipital artery is coming through this corner, it is actually supplying the semispinalis capitis and the superior oblique when it is taking this turn towards the suboccipital region on a deeper plane, it is close to the rectus capitis lateralis, and when it is coming here, it is again close to the superior oblique muscle. So over here you have semispinalis capitis, here you have superior oblique, rectus capitis posterior minor and major, and this is the way it is. And over here you have trapezius and sternocleidomastoid. So when this artery is coming up like this, it is supplying both semispinalis capitis and superior oblique. When it is going up, it is supplying rectus capitis lateralis, and when it is finally going into the scalp, it is actually piercing through the fascial connections between the trapezius and the sternocleidomastoid. So it is piercing this investing layer of deep cervical fascia from the back, and it is piercing the aponeurotic attachment of the trapezius over here, and then it is going up into the scalp. So apart from the two sternomastoid branches, you have muscular branches to all the surrounding muscles, right from the digastric triangle up to the vault of the skull. So you have muscular branches, and apart from this you have some other branches. One of the very important branches is the mastoid branch. So if you have, let us look at this picture. Here you have the occipital bone. By the side over here you have the mastoid part of the temporal bone, and in between the two, somewhere here, you have a mastoid foramen through which passes the mastoid emissary vein. So if you draw with blue a mastoid emissary vein, this is one of the structures which passes through. Not only that, a mastoid branch of the occipital artery, it also passes through this mastoid foramen. So when it passes through this mastoid foramen, it actually goes into the inside of the base of the skull, and it supplies some of these mastoid hair cells attached to the mastoid part of the temporal bone, and it supplies the dura mater from the inside of the posterior cranial fossa. So one of the important branches is this mastoid branch. Another thing is, when you are looking at the base of the skull from below, somewhere here you have the styloid process. If here you have the mastoid, suppose here you have the styloid, and in between here you have the stylomastoid foramen. Now the stylomastoid foramen, through the stylomastoid foramen emerges the facial nerve. So the facial nerve will come out of the stylomastoid foramen and it will form the extracranial part of the facial nerve. You already know that just when the facial nerve comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, it gives branch to the posterior belly of the digastric and the stylohyoid. So, and it gives branches which supplies the auricularis posterior. So this is the spot from where the facial nerve emerges, the stylomastoid foramen. So one of the branches of the occipital artery is the stylomastoid branch, which goes back through the stylomastoid foramen. So you have one branch of the occipital artery going into the mastoid foramen, which is the mastoid branch, and another branch going in through the stylomastoid foramen, which is the stylomastoid branch. Now apart from all this, when the occipital artery is going back, somewhere here you have the pinna, and this pinna has got an external surface, or it has got a lateral surface, and it has got a cranial surface. Now when this occipital artery is going back below the pinna, so it gives branches, it gives a branch rather, which is the auricular branch, to the cranial surface of the pinna, not to this surface that is facing out, not to this lateral surface, but the surface that is behind, to the cranial surface. And that, you know that above this occipital artery you are going to have another posterior auricular artery. That we are not discussing now, but you will have a posterior auricular artery somewhere here above the occipital artery, and that posterior auricular artery will also supply the auricle. Now this occipital artery also has an auricular branch. So the auricle is being supplied from the superficial temporal from front, and it is being supplied by the auricular branch from the occipital artery, and it is being supplied by an auricular branch from the auricular branches, multiple branches from the posterior auricular artery. So in all, from the occipital artery you are getting the two sternomastoid branches, you are getting an auricular branch, you are getting a branch going through the mastoid foramen, you are getting a stylomastoid branch. So all of these are branches of the occipital artery, and in dissection for the occipital artery, partly you have to look for it high up in the anterior triangle, that is in the digastric triangle. Next you have to search for it at the apex of the posterior triangle. Next you have to search for it at the uppermost reaches of the suboccipital region, and next you have to search for it within the scalp. That's enough for now, I think. Thank you.